Thanks everyone for coming, and thanks to Pew and the others for putting this together. I'll start with a punchline, is that survival is simply not enough. And so to address the question of when is restoration gone far enough, part of my work has said that it's when you actually have populations that are reproductive and able to contribute to the continuity of the populations going forward. I'm not showing anybody here anything they don't already know. When I started working on corals back in 1974, it's 48 years ago now, scary, my reefs in the Caribbean had 70% coral cover. I went back to some of those reefs 5 years ago and they were less than 2%. And I never would have thought of my worst nightmare that this would occur during my professional career. And I'll be honest, I went back to the hotel room and cried. I just couldn't believe Buck Island, Tague Bay, all these beautiful areas where our generation, many of our generation learned corals, was down to nothing. And so for that reason, the issue of coral restoration is just such an important topic. And I do look at this meeting as being an opportunity to put some optimism back. I explain to people that personally, I'm an optimist, otherwise I can't get out of bed in the morning. Professionally, I'm a pragmatist, otherwise I can't do my job. But this is what we're dealing with. Back in the 70s, elkhorn coral everywhere. When I went back to Buck Island, I found two tiny colonies, and people were excited that I actually found two. It's also the Pacific, and so these are things that, as Andrew pointed out, it's not just about one area, it's about all areas. The area in which I work is in a lot of the reproductive biology, and it's a cycle of starting with reproduction. It's one thing to produce gametes, they need to fertilize, larvae need to recruit, they need to survive, they need to grow and eventually get to maturity and come back out again. And the issue is that if you break any one of these links in the system, then you go downhill from there. The first areas, reproduction, are really tied to water quality, and recruitment is very much tied to bottom quality. So the two of them are inextricably linked. And then we can start to look at the various water quality parameters that are there. Water-soluble compounds are really bad against reproduction in the water column for spawners and brooders. Lipophilic substances, the fat-loving ones, are really wreaking havoc on the ability of larvae to recruit. And so if we look at the stages from what this is a spawning of a postal opera during the day, we know these are contagious spawning events. When the gamete water from this colony came down and hit another colony, it induced that one to go as well. So chemical signaling going on in the water. Egg-sperm interactions. This is a cluster from an acropora literally bursting apart with a surfactant that's in the egg-sperm cluster. And these eggs and sperm are going to interact. If all goes well, within a few hours, you'll get developing embryos. If all goes well and the water quality is good as these are drifting through the water, you'll get the planula larval forming. They can recruit if they get the proper signal, which is tied to the microbiome, and then eventually they'll pick up their zooxanthellae. But once again, everything here is chemically mediated, and everything here is dependent upon water quality and bottom quality. Anything that compromises that compromises the ability of coral reefs to persist over time through the natural processes of reproduction and recruitment. And so when we look at those, for corals, we know that first they need to survive from an energetic point of view before there's any energy available for growth. And if there's enough energy left over, then they can allocate some of their energy to reproduction. What we find in our work using proteomics, I'm a marine biologist, not a molecular biologist, but I use molecular tools to answer fundamental questions. And what we're finding is that many of the proteins that are tied to detoxification are the same proteins that run the reproductive machinery. So once again, we see kind of a continuum. First, the proteins that corals use for detoxification have to go to survival. If there's enough left over, the coral may be able to grow, and if there's enough of those proteins available, then they can begin to run the reproductive machinery. And this is what we're finding mechanistically, is that most corals are stuck at the survival stage. There's simply not enough of the decontaminating proteins left over to run the reproductive mechanism or to be able to even form the lipids necessary for eggs. The easiest way to describe it to people is kind of a principal and interest model. If you have a bank account with principal in it, that's a good thing. But if you have no interest and a high monthly fee, you go bankrupt. And that's exactly what we're seeing happening on coral reefs. Our principal is a standing stock of corals. But if they're non-reproductive and there's going to be mortality every year, which there is, then you're going to go to bankruptcy, which is what we're seeing. Parent colonies and juveniles are your principal. Gametes and larvae are the interest, but they don't matter unless they recruit and become part of the actual reef itself. So reproductive success only matters if recruitment follows, and 100% successful reproduction without recruitment is the same thing as 100% reproductive failure. At the population level, we have a number of considerations, and most people are familiar, or many people, with what's called the allele effect. These are sessile and benthic organisms, so it's their gametes that get to interact, and as you increase the separation distance between them, the ability for egg and sperm to interact drops off logarithmically. We've played around with some modeling. There seems to be about a 30% threshold, and again, this is not a overall, but people often say, is there a magic number? The answer is no. But once you get below 30% coral cover, it's almost impossible for any of these populations to become resilient and to be able to come back to any kind of population. It depends on the distribution. Genotypic and phenotypic diversity really matters. So we know that when we've tried to do self-fertilization experiments and simultaneous hermaphrodites, fertilization rates are extremely low. We know that when we outcross them, they're much higher. We can actually get higher hybrid success than we can get with self-fertilization. So you need to take a look at genetic diversity in there. And we know, too, that history has taught us all you have to do is look at the Irish potato famine. When you select for one characteristic like temperature, high temperature, ability to survive, you lose all the other genetic things. And how do you protect what will go on next year? In Panama, when I was there as a postdoc, we had the major bleaching event back in 1983. I did work with Peter Glynn, and everyone was worried about the high temperature. 2 years later, we had a upwelling event in low temperature. Everything that survived the high temperature died during the low temperature. Connectivity really matters in terms of upstream, downstream. So when you're considering replacing an area, you need to look at what's going up. You need to look at the corridors of transport for gametes and larvae, the water quality there, and you need to look at the bottom quality at the recipient site. Also, we need to look at gamete quality, and that's one of the areas, and we see the proteins being very helpful. When you compromise metabolic activity in corals, whether it's through the zooxanthellae, through turbidity, or through any number of stressors like sediment where they have to shed the mucus, you can get gametes that are forming, but if the lipid isn't there and the quality and the quantity isn't enough, not only does the fecundity go down, but even when they produce eggs, the eggs are non-viable. And we've been able to show this on many reefs during reproductive failure during spawning events. We had a very unique event happen in Hawaii. Hawaii sometimes leads the world in unique ways of killing corals. One of them was a molasses spill. And so in Honolulu Harbor, there was a barge that brought molasses from Maui, and when they were pumping it out, it spilled into the ocean, 135,000 gallons of molasses. EPA said, it's not hazardous, it's not our job. Public health said, yeah, it's not poisonous, it's not our job. But the guys from Aquatic and Wildlife said, corals are dying, fish are dying, it is our job. So I get a call 6 o'clock in the morning, hey Bob, we need help. A couple of my graduate students, very brave ones, went and dove in the harbor. It's the only day that they shut it down for diving. And we learned that, yeah, molasses does cause really bad damage. One of the things that happened, of course, bacteria just bloomed and oxygen plummeted to zero. 30,000 fish died within a period of a couple of days. Some fish could figure out that the oxygen was going down and they got out, but they can't taste sugar. And those that stuck around, their gills exploded due to osmotic pressure. We didn't know at the time, but there were these luxuriant reefs inside of Honolulu Harbor. And that's where the term cockroach corals from one of my graduate students came up. No self-respecting coral should live in Honolulu Harbor. And yet, you know, you've got heavy metals from anti-fouling paints, you've got oil spills going on all the time, you've got temperature, you've got runoff from urban Honolulu. And these corals were not only growing, they were thriving, they were reproducing, there were recruits everywhere. One of the few corals that survived is Leptastria purpurea, a small coral that planulates on a regular basis. And even though my graduate students, undergraduates, are really, really good at killing corals, this is one species where they've not been too successful. So can we learn from them? What is it about Leptastria purpurea that enables it to do all kinds of things? These two diagrams, one on the left is a non-metric, multidimensional scaling plot showing corals from Palau, where I do a lot of my work. These are for parietes. And what we were doing is comparing protein expression patterns from corals from three different areas. Nirmadu Bay area, the one in the upper left in green, is an estuary with a lot of sediment coming down into it. Nico Bay, the Palauan name is Nirmid Bay, is very unique because it's growing at what we expected the world to look like by the year 2050. Average temperature there is about 32 degrees, and the pH is about 7.9. So it's running at a really bad scenario for climate change. Corals are thriving there. They're reproducing. There's good diversity. The larvae are recruiting. How do they do it? Oolong Island is this really incredibly pristine reef of incredible biodiversity, but when we compared their protein patterns, they're incredibly distinct. And in the map on the right, we just have FST values to show genetically they're completely different. The population in Near Mid Bay has probably been isolated from the other sites by 5,000 years due to sea level changes. And what we're seeing is that at this point, and this is why corals are such a pain in the butt, we call this Prades lobata. Who knows what they are? I've been studying postal Opodamicornis since 79. It's probably one of the most well-studied in corals in the world and least understood. Some populations spawn, some populations brood. If they're reproductive isolated, they're different species. So what does it tell us is we have different genetic variants out there that are attuned and have acclimated and been able to adjust to these changing environments. So what can we learn from cockroach corals and these corals that are living where no coral should? We have an area in Mauna Loa Bay, which is a classic watershed discharge from a high island with really, really bad water close to shore. The inner area in green is right off of a marina, again, a really bad point source for pollution. And if you look at the MDS plot on the lower right-hand side, you can see that the protein expression patterns segregate with distance from shore. Near shore, we have a lot of the detoxification proteins coming out. The middle sites, three and site T, are sites that are overrun with invasive algae. So we see oxidative stress proteins. And what really took us by surprise is blue, we saw DNA damage proteins. And we were trying to figure out what in the world would cause DNA damage out there. Turns out all the homes on the right side of that slide have swimming pools. When they clean the pools, they drain the pools into the ocean, bromine and chlorine, bang, DNA damage. So we know that we can use these protein analyses to really guide where we are. And the good news is that they're not only able to do this qualitatively to show where things are, but quantitatively we go from hot, close to shore to offshore, and they work in a dose-dependent manner. This is pretty self-explanatory, so I won't go into detail, but this is called a keg pathway. We call them subway maps. It's the Kyoto Encyclopedia for Gene and Genomes. What I want to point out is in the upper right-hand area, it's red. That's the xenobiotic metabolism. Those are the decontamination, the detoxification proteins. When we see those light up, we know it's at a tremendous cost to reproduction. And the punchline there is that survival is not enough, and we call this the curse of the zombie corals. We see year after year of large corals that are surviving but not reproducing, and a reef that has that and no recruits is a dead reef. It just doesn't know it yet. So I'll stop there. Thank you very much.